You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Dr. Teodros Avery. I'm the Associate Professor of Jazz Studies here at Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. And today will be the ninth session of the class entitled Key Movements, The Age of Jazz. Today, I'll be speaking about some of the great painters and artists of the Harlem Renaissance. We will cover people such as Romare Bearden and Archibald Motley. The first artist that we're going to learn about is Romare Bearden. Here he is right here. There he is, Romare Bearden. Romare Bearden was born on September 2nd, 1911 in Charlotte, North Carolina. His art encompasses a broad range of intellectual and scholarly interests, including music, performing arts, history, literature, and world art. Bearden began college at Lincoln University, transferred to Boston University, and graduated at New York University, graduating with a degree in education. After joining the Harlem Artists Guild, Bearden embarked on his lifelong study of art, gathering inspiration from Western masters ranging from Duccio, Giotto, and de Hooch to Cezanne, Picasso, and Matisse, as well as from African art, particularly sculptures, masks, and textiles, Byzantine mosaics, Japanese prints, and also Chinese landscape paintings. Bearden was a prolific artist whose works were exhibited throughout his lifetime and also throughout the United States and Europe. His collages, watercolors, oils, photo montages, and prints are imbued with visual metaphors from his past in Mecklenburg County, North Carolina, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and Harlem, New York, and from a variety of historical, literary, and musical sources. Bearden is recognized as one of the most creative and original visual artists of the 20th century. He experimented with many different mediums and artistic styles, but he's best known for his richly textured collages. Now, if I can explain what I mean by his collages, it's very original in that he would take pictures from newspaper clippings, he would take materials from other from other objects, and then he would find a way to blend them all together. Now, what he would do that was really interesting, he would take someone's face. Maybe there was a face in a magazine. Maybe he would cut out one of the eyes, take another magazine, cut out someone else's lips, take another magazine, cut out someone else's nose, and then he would mismatch them all together to make one face. So you would look at a face and it had so much character and expression in the facial expression. But if you looked really closely, you would find that each part of the face might have been from a different area. So you wouldn't have two eyes that were the same, or you know, the same nose and lips from the same picture. You would have a piece of this person, a piece of that person, a piece of that person. He would put them all together. He would use scissors and he would cut up these different pieces and parts. And then he would stick them onto canvas. And the colors he used were created with inks and graphite, often on brown paper. And then he would sometimes even photograph what he had created and then use that in the overall collage. So it was a process that he developed that was very original to his own expression. And when you see, as you will see in this class, you will see how his style was very, very original, different from anyone else's. Here we have an example right here. It's called Memory from 1964. So look at the face. Look at either face. Let's start with the one on the left. You can see that eye is from, well, the eye and the nose is from one person, but then the other half of the nose on the right side is from another person. And the eyes, see the eye on the right is different from the one on the left. And even if you look on the forehead of the one on the left, it's from two different pictures. Because you can see it by, if you look at the hairline, you'll see two different hairlines. So the hairline on the left side of the forehead comes down further, where the one on the right is further back. And they're almost two different shades of color. Very, very original approach to his collages. that no one else had done,
To my knowledge, and also to most people who know this art, no one else did anything like this. And then you can see his ears were different. There's another picture right here where he takes his bits and pieces.
In this one, he didn't cut out the individual parts of the face.
But he did take a face from a whole nother picture and put it on this piece of artwork. And you can see all the people in the photo or in the collage, they're not really related. These are, you know, four different faces from four different pieces of maybe a magazine, a newspaper, or anything like that. But it's definitely
not four people sitting in a room together, right, that he took a picture of or
took their faces from. And then you can see how the face is much larger than the body. You see that? So he's mismatching body faces and heads with bodies to create a mood. And with that, you have a reason to really focus in on the facial expressions because they jump out beyond the size of the bodies. So he's trying to get us to really see these people and see their expressions on their faces.
Let's go to another picture.
Okay, same deal. The guy on the right, I mean, his whole body is mismatched. You've got purples and reds, and the shapes are purposely not fitting exactly how they would if, you ran into this person on the street. He's definitely trying to obscure the shape of the people. And it looks really, really nice with the different colors, the blues, the reds, the purples, the violets. All very original and very, very makes you wonder what's going on. What was this person trying to express to me? Because the one on the left is looking at me right in my face. It makes you want to know who they are, you know? And let's go on to the next one. We'll see another picture. Okay, here we have musicians performing. It's called Three Folk Musicians. And you can see them jamming out somewhere, playing music. And you see the guitars, the banjos, two guitars and a banjo. And again, their faces are unclear. And here in particular, you can see the style of the African masks on those figures, especially the one in the middle. You can see that influence if you know the African masks from the West, from West Africa, that are very popular in the African American art world. You can recognize those shapes, almond shaped eyes, the nose. Let's go to the next one. And then here you have jazz musicians at a club. And they're all playing, and this one's called Out Chorus. He created a number of pieces related to jazz music because he really loved jazz music, and also he lived in Harlem, and jazz was just the language of African Americans in Harlem at that time. So there he probably went to a club to go hear some musicians.
What's interesting is that the majority of the band members have regular sized bodies, you know, in proportion to their heads. But if you look at the drummer, he's the only one with a really short arm.
So, you know, that'll throw you a little bit if you're used to seeing like the other shapes, the other human beings in the photo, they look like regular people, and then the drummer has a shorter arm.
And also the trumpet player in the background, further back.
His shape is different as well.
So he did a mix right there between his smaller shapes with regular sized heads.
And then regular sized musicians. I'm sure he did that on purpose. And again, you see the beautiful colors, the yellow, the blue, the deep blue, pink. And then here we have some jazz musicians again. You got the acoustic bass up front. And notice now, this is the first time in which the musicians are not making any sort of expressions. They just have black faces, totally black. No eyes, no nose, which makes me feel like maybe they were playing in a dark club. and he probably couldn't see them that well. And so he said, you know what, I'm just going to go with a totally black face and then go with the instruments. And the musicians are totally not shortened or made to be small in this picture right here. They're pretty proportionate to their heads and arms and everything. So he's not tricking you there, and that's a total change. This one is called The Blues People. There you go right there. Okay, let's go to the next one. Okay, this is a photo of a band in a jazz club. This one is called Empress of the Blues. And so you have the lady up front, she's singing the blues, and then you have the band in the background supporting her. And you can see how that's a total big band, because they've got three saxophones and one clarinet. And then they've got the rhythm section performing. And she's up front. She looks like, I'm trying to see what she has in her hand. Is that a glass? Not sure. Looks like a glass. I wonder if she's having a drink while she's singing. Not uncommon for some people to have a drink while they're singing. It relaxes them. But yeah, so we'll go to the next picture now. Okay, and there's Romare Beardner, and that's a photo of him. And he's just having a cigarette somewhere in New York City, probably. Yeah, so he's just chilling out with a cigarette and a stingy brim hat on. For the people that know clothes, you know, the stingy brim is when there's less fabric on the brim. Stingy, you know, people who are stingy, they don't give you a lot. So that's a stingy brim. Not a lot of brim there. Okay, so now we have now this is Paris Blues, I believe. Yeah, this is Paris Blues. Now, what's special about this picture is that it was the result of a collaboration between Romare Beardner, the writer Albert Murray, and the photographer Sam Shaw. And in this collage, we have two individuals that were titans of jazz music. We have Duke Ellington on the left, and then we have Louis Armstrong with the trumpet in the middle right. And there's two pictures of Louis Armstrong on the bottom and in the middle. So the bottom right is Louis Armstrong, and the middle is Louis Armstrong, and then the left side is Duke Ellington. And then up on the top, we have, again, one of the African masks looking down. And actually, interestingly enough, it looks like it could be someone related to Louis Armstrong. Same shape of face and head and eyes. That's a really nice one right there. The different colors, the blue, red, and pink, and black and white. Very, very nice. Okay.
So now we're going to look at a documentary called Five African American Artists. This is from 1971. It features Romare Beardner, among other artists. I chose this documentary because you will hear exactly how Romare Beardner felt about his own art. Again, I always stress in this class that whenever I get an opportunity to let the artists speak for themselves,
I really like to let them do so, instead of always hearing an interpretation of how they felt and how they were inspired by different things in their art. So here we go. This is, again, Five African American Artists.
I think if the artist was the only person in the world, he wouldn't paint, because you paint in relation to other people. Suppose, for instance, a friend visited me and I wasn't here, and he left a card so that I would know he was here. And the things that I do are like leaving my visiting cards, so that my works say, Romy was here. Not long ago, a young artist picked up some of my visiting cards off the cover of Fortune magazine. He was going to the little gallery, the Sinkhe Gallery, named for the famous African prince who led a mutiny in the 1830s aboard a slave ship. I'm on the board of directors along with Norman Lewis and Ernest Critchlow. We three established this gallery to give needed exposure to minority artists, and I think that we have some little obligation to the young, deserving people who are coming along.
I really appreciate your coming over to see my work, Mr. Bearden.
Everything looks just fine. I think it's one of our real fine shows that we had here. The same movements that I see in the painting, I see continued in some of your sculpture, like that piece over there. It's very similar to your painting. And it seems like you're very fond of this kind of undulating movement.
So this gallery gives these artists a kind of a pat on the back.
Gives me a lot of freedom.
Of course, it was a little different when I started to paint, which was during the height of the Depression. I had been trained at first as a mathematician, but when I got out of college, there was nothing to count but the unemployed. So I took a studio on 125th Street above that of Jacob Lawrence. The great poet and novelist Claude McKay was in the same building. And if we weren't at my studio, we usually went to the studio of Charles Alston. We met the artists and the intellectuals, and we had a real little going community. So this was a great deal in enhancing whatever development I've made as an artist. As for my own work, what I've tried to do is to take the elements of Afro-American life in this country as I see it. That is to place it in a universal framework. For instance, in my show at the Museum of Modern Art, I have a baptism scene. And I've tried to relate the people in my painting of the baptism to a myth even back in Africa. I've used certain masks to try to show the heritage that relates these people in my painting back to a certain past. However, I constantly, with the encouragement of my wife, who's helped me so much, try to reach within my own consciousness and memory and bring forth a people that I've known and seen, and let them take their place on certain works that I'm doing. Some stand and some sit, some sleep, just what they want to do after the painting gets started. I use papers often that I paint myself, others I buy colored. I use some photograph often from magazines, pieces of cloth and other material. In many ways, it's like putting a symphony together or a piece of music, a certain melody going of colors and then certain contrapuntal elements that play against this. One of my works I call The Block, and it's about a particular block, 133rd Street and Lenox Avenue, that I've tried to, in my imagination, x-ray and tell something about the life of the people. This block is another calling card that I've left. It said, I've observed and passed by that I was here.
So the great thing about this video that we just saw was that these artists can explain to the viewer what they meant, right, and what inspired them. And what's important to know is that during this time, especially, it still happens today, of course, but during this time especially, these artists were right alongside the civil rights movement. So as you had people, you know, who were legislatively trying to, you know, break ground for black people in terms of civil rights, you know, whether it be, you know, the right to vote, the right to a fair and equal education, you know, not having to sit in the back of the bus, all these different issues, that you had these artists off to the side who were drawing, who were writing, who were painting, and they were inspired by the movement of the civil rights era, and then they would see the people as they were, you know, living the lives that were affected by the civil rights struggle, and that they were inspired by what they saw, and then they would put it into their art. And so that is why a lot of the shapes resemble the people who were, you know, of the time, and they were purposely trying to relate to those people. And in situations like Langston Hughes, who we spoke about in the last class or the last one of the last sessions, he was on the pulse of, you know, African middle class African Americans, and really wanted to also speak to them through his poetry. So he was different from someone who was, say, more separated from the middle class. He was one of those people who was right in there, and so was Romare Bearden. He was in Harlem. He would go to clubs to listen to jazz. He would be inspired by the movement, by the civil rights movement, and he would also make art that was directly influenced by the civil rights movement. So that's why Romare Bearden and people like him were very important, and also the artists in this documentary we just saw, Five American Artists. Now we're going to hear a different perspective. We're going to hear historians, experts, and personal friends talk about Romare Bearden's series, A Black Odyssey. This is one of his works, so let's check this out.
Romare Bearden was an American artist of the greatest importance, whose innovations were many, but who's best known for his incredible collage work. He was an African American who, through his art, told the epic story of African America at the same time that he was so committed to telling the story of mankind in general.
Romare Bearden was born in 1911 in Charlotte, North Carolina, and he died in 1988, so he went through a long life of changes in the United States, a lot of changes in the world. He saw a lot. He was an African American who looked white to many people, and so I think he also learned a lot about humanity.
He was a poet of Harlem who told that story. He was also a great Southern landscape painter. He gave you the interiors of spaces north and south, and when it came to the south, he made you think again about those breakfast tables and passageways upstairs and places where you'd bathe and cook and so on. And so without any nostalgia, he evokes scenes that people knew north and south, especially Black Americans.
I feel that what struck me about the Odyssey is that all of us, from the time we begin to think, are on an Odyssey. In this case, home, looking for the values that are kind of everlasting, you know, we use our home. Or Telemachus, the son, the search for the father. And this is applicable to everyone.
Romare Bearden first created the Odysseus series for a show that appeared in 1977 at Courtier and Ekstrom Gallery on the East Side in Manhattan. He'd been reading Homer for many years because he'd done the Iliad series in the 40s. And so he had been meditating on this for quite some time.
I think he turned to the Odyssey because it was just like a glove. It just was such a clear metaphor for the experience of African Americans and maybe his own experience.
Homer's Odyssey is described as a great Greek epic that is a foundation of Western literature. It's the story of Odysseus and his trip back home after the wars. On his way back home, Odysseus meets a series of gods and goddesses, especially goddesses, some of whom direct him on his way back home and rescue him. Others fall in love with this beautiful man and want him for themselves.
The Odysseus series, when he asked me to come in to photograph him, and I saw him in his studio, I couldn't believe that a man did these. I thought maybe a machine had done them, or they had been offset litho or something. The pieces themselves were so different than anything I had seen before. So, it took me a little while to understand that he had actually done these.
And I attended that show, and you walk inside and you get a jolt that here are these remarkable colors leaping out at you.
The thing is, he did the watercolors afterwards. So in these photographs and the images that I took, he's at the table in St. Martin upstairs in his studio, and he's working on the Odessa series. And he's already traced the outline, and he's just adding the colors to it. He's got the book from the catalog from the show that he did. So I'm sure he's looking to see what colors went into each piece. And he's got his palette here, and he's got his inks, his watercolor, and he's just filling it in.
Bearden makes the characters in Odysseus as black as he can make them. Here's an African-American artist telling a black story and making it unequivocally our story, purchasing the story as one for black America. We too are seeking home. We too have been through love and trouble and temptation and death and terrible suffering, and somehow we are the heroes of this story.
Right. Very, very interesting. Next, we're going to move on to Archibald Motley. Archibald Motley was born on October 7, 1891 in New Orleans, Louisiana. He and his family moved up to the Northwest to Chicago, Illinois. It was in Chicago where he studied painting at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. After turning down a full scholarship to study architecture at the Illinois Institute of Technology. Most of Motley's most popular works focus on nightlife among African Americans. The scenes often depict people performing, singing, dancing, drinking, and having a great time. Here's a painting called Hot Rhythm. Hot Rhythm, look at the colors in Hot Rhythm. Notice how the faces in the very back of the painting still have as much definition and facial expressions as the faces in the front of the picture. It doesn't degrade as you look back. Everyone is important, everyone's having a good time. He was careful to really show the viewer how expressive everyone was in the midst of so much fun. And you get to really feel like you're looking at a situation in a club, you know, where everybody's playing music. The trumpet player's looking right at us in the front. You know, the piano player's turning around. He's got a facial expression on his face. And then you got the beautiful women dancing, and they're having a good time. And nobody's bothering them, right? That's always good to see. Ladies having a good time and not being bothered. And then you see the guys, and they're gentlemen. You see them, they're listening to the music and just really enjoying it. That's a beautiful, beautiful combination of colors. Look at the greens, the blues, the blacks, and then the browns. Nice balance between the colors. Okay, in this next photo, we see a similar scene, except here many of the people are resting and some are dancing. And so you see some are at the bar and they're just chilling out. And then you've got the people dancing on the right side. Yeah, and then you see the people, you see the bartenders. You know how bartenders are, they're always very serious. And they're getting bottles off the wall, and then you have one bartender, he's just looking at everybody. It seems like he might be looking right at Archibald. You know, the way he's looking right at us. And then all the way to the back, you can see people dancing and really having a good time, and it looks very elegant. Notice the suits that the men are wearing, nice tailored suits, and then you have the ladies in very nice dresses, and you see the influence of, the French influence in the dresses and in the hair, the bob haircuts. Yeah, that's from the flappers. We spoke about the flappers earlier in the class, and so you see that French influence on these ladies as well. Okay, and then we're going to go to another photo. And in the following photo, we see a woman. This is basically a close-up of the last picture that we just saw. But you see, now you can see the woman at the bar, and the bartender speaking to her. And even if she might be speaking to her friend, but the bartender's listening, and he's probably waiting to see if she wants another drink. But you get all of that by looking at these pictures and these paintings. And you can see the conversation between the couples on the right. There's a couple on the bottom right. And actually, if you look closely, the guy on the left, he's talking right to the ladies. The guy on the left in the hat, he's talking to the lady in the green.
So there's a lot of expression and detail in these pictures, which is different from Romare Bearden, where Romare really plays on how you see shapes of faces, and he plays on the facial expression, how it can be such or much more of a deep look in people's faces because of the mismatching of the shapes, the eyes, the nose, the lips. Here you get to see that there's more emphasis on the conversation and the way that the people are cohabitating and dancing and stuff like that. So it's a little bit of a different style. Many similar colors, but a different style. Now we're going to move on to another, there we go, another painting. Now what's interesting here, and what's good is that you see people mixing from different backgrounds. So you have African Americans, Caucasians, everyone kind of like coming together. You even see different generations. You see young people. This is obviously a barbecue type of situation because the guy in the middle is barbecuing. But you see the young lady, the little girl in the front. She got a popsicle or an ice cream. And then you see older people that she's around. So now you get a much more of a mix between the groups. And you probably just went out to a picnic. Well, probably went out to just go view some kind of outing. And then he was able to see all these different people cohabitating and just wanted to mix it all together, which is great. Okay. And then we'll go on to the next one. And then we're back to the club. Here, couples dance while the band plays. Notice the beautiful smile that the woman has while she looks at the band as they perform. So a lot of gratitude for music and jazz shown between the audiences and the musicians, the players. And she's looking right at them like they're making the band, they're making the moment really nice, playing really good music, and she gets to dance with her man. And then you see the couples on the right. The couple on the right, and then in the back, and then you see the couple at the table. So he really captured the essence of the times that he was living during this time in Chicago. And it was a good time, and it was a very, Chicago was like New York. Chicago really had its own thing going, as New York did. So they were happy being in Chicago, and it shows. Now we're going to watch part one of a short documentary on Archibald Motley, and it's called Archibald Motley, A Stroll. So let's check this out. Archibald Motley, A Stroll.
He really is one of America's premier modernists.
You know, you want to be a part of this nightclub in Paris or a nightclub in Chicago. You want to be drinking at 1 a.m. and dancing and having a wonderful time.
I like to call Motley the painter laureate of the black modern cityscape.
When we talk about Archibald Motley, we're talking about an artist that is aesthetically a part of a particular moment in time, the early to mid 20th century. Archibald Motley was a product of the Art Institute of Chicago, and that school was a renowned school for educating students to the rules of color, of composition, of light, of just all of the things that a good artist knew. And as Picasso said, you had to know the rules in order to break the rules. And blues is a good example of Archibald Motley not only knowing how to paint in an academic, traditional way, but then improvising on that, having fun with that, altering it, pushing and pulling, so that you have these reds against whites, you have these blues against pinks. In fact, he's pushed against basic notions of representationalism. They are literally people of color. They have pink skins, they have magenta skins, they have blue-black skins. And so Archibald Motley, as I said, knows the rules and breaks the rules in order to make a major modern artistic statement.
He adopted a style that's much broader, in some ways much less academic in nature. And you see it in blues, which is right behind me here. He is choosing to paint in this style because we know from his portraits that he was a master painter. So I think that this choice that he made to sort of break with academic convention was a way of approaching different audiences.
There was a review done of blues in Chicago in the early 30s. And the reviewer, who was based here in Chicago, was kind of taken aback that Archibald Motley would be so brazen to take on a subject so risque, and at the same time give it the seriousness of art. And so while there are transgressive elements in these works that perhaps rubbed very, very snooty people the wrong way, I think many people vicariously were delighted and excited by the idea that here is an artist who takes on this subject and doesn't just do it in a simplistic way, but does it in a serious way, treats it serious, and raises it to the level of a major modern artistic statement.
Very good description of Archibald Motley by that man. And now we're going to look at part two of the same documentary so you can learn more about Archibald Motley and how to actually see his art through a certain perspective. And it will help you understand why he is important and why his art was so effective on people. Here we go, part two.
So we're heading south from Motley's Art Institute of Chicago, where he was a student and was trained. And we're heading south into the area that would later be called Bronzeville, that he represented so beautifully in his paintings. These, what he called these urban nocturnes, these street scenes, these night scenes. There's a quote from him saying that it was these night scenes where you find a lot of my race. That's what interested me. And that was for a reason, because as we head south and into what was becoming the Stroll, it was a vibrant urban landscape. And you know, I like to call Motley the painter laureate of the Black modern cityscape. And he really reflected the energy, the dynamism, the action, the pace of Black urban living in the face of real constraints, real racial constraints.
I am also a figurative painter, you know, as Motley was a figurative painter. The neighborhood itself is a worthy subject for artwork, just as it was for Motley. Being in a neighborhood like this, it's a remarkable place. You know, it really is a remarkable place. You know, for all the challenges that one has to negotiate in a neighborhood, in neighborhoods that struggle economically, It's a remarkable place, and there's a style of living, there's a sound of life that is really appealing and satisfying to me.
I think for myself as a young person who first got the idea to be an artist when I was a teenager, actually seeing work by and of African-American artists is what began to legitimate the possibility. Seeing his work made me realize that there were African-American artists. You know, this sense of possibility became real. It began to reaffirm the notion that I might in fact be this thing that I was thinking about being. It made me want to be a part of that history.
Like that music. That's what we call a shuffle. And you know, musicians, they call that a shuffle. So it's a certain sound that the drums have. Do to cat to boot to pat to boot to pat to boot tat to boom pat to boom tat to boom tap boom ba tap boom. Shuffle. That's what that was.
All right, well, at this point I would like to mention to all the people who are watching, if you are a musician
and you are interested in studying music, we would really like for you to visit our website. It is the website of Cal State University Dominguez Hills. It's csudh.edu/music. And if you're interested in studying music, please visit us. Find out about audition times and everything like that. We're doing some great things over here, led by our music director, department chair, Dr. Scott Morris, and he's doing some great things that we would love for you to be a part of. So if you're interested, reach out to us. And then also, if you get a chance, please visit my website, which is www.teodrosavery.com. Teodrosavery.com. And there you can find information about when I'm performing out, when I'm touring, and my bio, and a lot of good stuff. You can even buy my music there. So we want you to check us out, keep in touch, and get involved if you're interested.
This concludes session number 9 of the class Key Movements, The Age of Jazz. We want to thank you for listening. Students, make sure you take good notes, because the notes will help you on the different tests. And I don't want you to say, what are we going to be tested on? Just take good notes and you'll be fine. All right. Thank you so much. Have a good day. Bye-bye.